Commissioner? Are you ready for questions?
I'm ready to answer all your questions.
Okay, some of them.
Unless you have none.
No, some of them have already, been answered in the presentation, for example, tasers. And there were a few others.
I'm ready.
The overtime, he expressed the concerns regarding overtime and why the overtime is really, not likely to be adhered to because of changing environment in which we live. Well, leave it at that. But I do have members of the Public Safety Committee. They have a number of questions that I'm going to just say one thing. You know, from day one, I am not going to be happy unless we add two more to each precinct of the courthouse. This is something we need, and this is something the communities are crying for, and they see the value of the pop cups. So, remember that.
I need mine in the legislative house.
I'm not going to let go of that one. There's a class coming out, I believe you said in January?
First week of January.
Okay, so that's the direction we're going.
Okay.
As far as the pop cups are concerned. Because you did say that with the next class, we will probably be able to add two more. I don't know whether or not you're going to stick to that, but that's where, this is what the communities want to hear.
And I agree with you wholeheartedly. The only thing is keep in mind that with any moves we make, they're not going to be a patrol going to be there, just, you know, and I have no objections to it. I love the pop cops.
We can continue to talk about it.
Okay.
In the meantime, we have the chairperson of the Public Safety Committee has some questions he would like to ask you, and Denise Ford. I believe, they're on the Public Safety Committee, so they should be able to be heard. And of course, you can also chime in, legislator Nicolello, and we have legislator Birnbaum, Karen, anybody else, and okay. All right, let's go.
It'd be easy if you ask, who doesn't want to ask questions?
My questions are going to, there's quite a few, but they're going to be. They're real quick. You covered most everything. You said that class is coming out in January. That's not considered the 2017 class.
No, we're actually gearing up to hire a class the first week of December. And so they'll be in field training. The class is graduating the first week of January. And then we're preparing to hire another class in the spring of next year.
Excellent. And the number again in the classes?
So what I'm hoping is the county executive has been, get them in as quickly as he can. He's, wants to get the cops on the street. We have to wait and see what clears backgrounds, but if I get my way, it'll be 120 officers in the class coming up in the first week of December, and then a pretty comparable class in next spring.
So the investigations for those guys that are coming in, that's what's holding up the guys in
the house? They've just been, basically what's happening is over since 2014, as fast as they can investigate, we've been hiring. And it's not just the investigation from our people. We have 25 people assigned to help the investigation. You also have the civil service side of it. So they had to go through psychologicals. Everybody has to get a psychological. And remember, it's not just the people we hire. It's every single person in the process is getting these. Everybody that clears phase one, which is the background, and then goes to phase two, has to get a medical, has to get a psychological, has to get a polygraph. So we're literally doing hundreds and hundreds of investigations. And what happens is, as we get later into the list and deeper into the list, and the list gets older, we go through more and more people. So we're doing more and more investigations in order to get one person.
But not expediting it to the extent where somebody will slip through the cracks.
Absolutely not. I will not compromise in that way.
Okay. Just want to make that on the record.
Yep.
Now the pop cop stuff will be talked about with Madam Chair. She's the champion of the pop cop, so
I sort of got the opinion 19 of you were the champions of pop cops.
Thank you. The biggest cheerleader. You said you had 24 cars with the rifle boxes in and out.
We have 24 cars that'll be getting rifle boxes, and we're ordering another 24 boxes. So once that, you know, that's the thing is, we're going to put the rifles in the cars, only those that are trained will have access to the rifles. That, you know, ultimately we'll have about a third of the cars that will have rifles.
Okay, the training is ongoing?
The training will start and gear up again. That goes back to the overtime and, you know, the number of people. But we are identifying the people that will be trained. You know, obviously we're asking for volunteers. And where those boxes go, the primary operators will have to be rifle trained, so we're going to have to jockey around some cops.
So it's not all the officers that will be trained?
No. It becomes cost prohibitive to train every officer in the department.
Now, the tasers, the new recruits coming out, they're freshly trained with them.
Yep.
Why aren't they being given? Because they're just trained with it, so.
They are being given them.
Oh, they are?
Yes, absolutely. So what happens is, you know, this is a new technology, and, you know, we wanted to roll it out, you know, very calculated, so we were holding back a little bit, but now where we're at is we're pushing them out. You know, we've had a good track record. What we're seeing with the tasers is, with the new use force policy, one of the things I didn't talk about was, anytime a taser is drawn and used as a de-escalator, they're also reporting on that. Any physical force is being reported on. So we are capturing all the use of force. And what we're seeing with the tasers is that for every one time it's discharged, there's several times where just drawing it de-escalates the situation.
That's good.
Let's piggyback on the taser. All of those who graduated from the academy,
yes,
were trained in taser, right?
Yes.
Are they all going to be given tasers?
So basically, initially it was waiting for them to get on probation as we were growing the program. And now what happened is we've released all the tasers. So every single police officer has been hired since 2014 that's on probation, not probation, will have tasers by this Friday.
Okay, so even if they're on probation,
they'll be getting tasers.
Okay, thank
yeah.
you.
Now I'm going to crossing guards. The crossing guards.
Okay.
Crossing guards, you're just hiring 30 more crossing guards is what the figure was?
So what happened was, I'll hire as many as I can, but what happened was we went through over 200 investigations and that gave us a pool of 36 crossing guards that we hired in the summer. That should have been enough to cover every single crossing guard post before people went sick and they took days off. What happened was, with the change in the crossing guards, we have been losing crossing guards at on a rate that we didn't expect. So right now, where we're at is we have 9 crossings in the county that don't have a crossing guard assigned to it, so they get picked up by the police officers. Then we have 11 people that are on long-term sick. Okay, so what we've done is we are looking to expedite the investigations of all the crossing guards that have put applications in, all the applicants that we have, about 125. Unfortunately, that will probably only yield somewhere in the neighborhood of 18 to 20. And I'll hire all of them, it's just a matter of how many I can get out of that 100. I'll investigate 125 people, but for a number of reasons, that will only yield 18 to 20 hires. So we are doing that, we're doing that as quickly as possible. The two places that are the most problematic is the 4th precinct, and the 5th precinct, 4th precinct being the worst. And we moved some crossing guards from other precincts down there to sort of balance out the shortages. What happened then was they started quitting because they didn't want to go from Belmore or Merrick or Elmont down into the 1st precinct, you know, the 4th precinct. So what we now have to do is really have to beef up down there, and that's going to be the one that I think lags behind. But if I keep putting people there, and they'll keep quitting, which will create, you know, a worse problem.
Yeah. The one problem that came up from a few of the residents said,
No, I was just pointing out that obviously the class sizes going forward, now that we're getting up to the budget, if the budget's passed at 2,500, now that we're getting up to that number, the class sizes will be based on pending retirements and retirements as we move forward.
Okay. Now, as far as crossing guards go, I've heard complaints that on the corners where they have no stoppers to near the corner, people pull in there and they curse at the crossing guard because I'm just going to run my kid and leave me alone, and they leave me on there, buses now can't turn in, and backing up traffic like no tomorrow. the suggestion was to use the plate reader, zap the card with the plate, and then send the ticket to their home, because they are obstructing the schools, you know, this is what some of them...
That would be a great idea, I implore it, I love it, all we need is a little state legislation.
State legislation.
State legislation. So it's, yeah, no, it's, you know, like anything else, that, I will tell you, legislator, is a problem since I was a police officer. There was schools that had these chronic problems. And when that happens, the Coast Guard reaches out to the supervisor of the precinct, and they'll assign some cars down there in order to mitigate that issue.
Now, questions that I had, you covered in your presentation, so I'm gonna get it back to Madam Chair. Denise Ford.
Legislative Board.
All right, thank you very much for your presentation, and I don't have that many questions, but I just want to piggyback on, go back to the school crossing guards. How long does it take, you know, from the moment somebody puts in an application to be a school crossing guard to the time that when he or she is hired?
So the big part of the investigation is the medical, and what we find is the medical is very time consuming. So basically, if we start investigating somebody, it could take 4 or 5 months before that investigation is completed. And like right now, like I stated, right now we're looking to expedite those investigations.
And how many applications did you say you received?
The last pool, so we had 200 applications. We investigated all of them. It 220, I didn't get the exact number, but that yielded a pool of 36 hires.
Right. I guess I'm just going to go back, because you know, I always have an issue with the fact that we took this position and where it was full time, and it seems we never had an issue of hiring school crossing guards in the past when they were full time, where these basically women, and I apologize to any of the other school crossing guards if I use a feminine pronoun and referring to them, but these women, you know, they. Were able, you know, they made a better salary. They not only did school crossings, but they also then would go and work within the precincts on some things as well. And it has been, I guess, the intent of the county to move them from all full-time to all part-time. And that would be my concern, that even though, I mean, it is, they're making less money, and it is less expensive for the county, but I wonder if that's one of the reasons why, you know, we have so many problems bringing in new school crossing guards.
So, okay, you touched on a number of things that I think requires some clarification. Number one, you touched on the fact that full-time crossing guards would come in and do work at the precinct. The CSCA filed a grievance and basically said that was out of title work. So basically what happened is the clerk's unit within the CSCA filed a grievance that the crossing guards were doing their work. Carl Camp advised me that if that was not permitted, and if I continued the practice, I would be committing a crime. So crossing guards now are only permitted to do crossings, nothing else. Okay, so that's the first thing. So the second item we touched on is that resulted in sort of an unanticipated consequence. So we were using those crossing guards exactly like you stated, those full-time, those 230 full-time crossing guards. And we were using them exactly like you stated, where they were doing clerical work, and they got additional hours because they were full-time employees, and we weren't paying them overtime. So we were using them in that way, and I think it was a great use of resources. I agree with you. Unfortunately, we can't do that anymore. So now these crossing guards were getting a significant number of hours. Now they're not. So what's happening? They're all retiring because some of these crossing guards were getting an extra 20 hours a week, a paycheck. And now they're all retiring. So when we have finally got to a point that we were stabilizing the crossing guard issue with what you just said, you know, that really threw a monkey wrench into things. The other item is it is a lot more stable to hire a crossing guard and tell them you're going to give them a $20,000 health insurance package and guarantee them 20 hours a week, 52 weeks a year. It's also a lot more expensive. So to put this in perspective, the full-time crossing guard costs Nassau County about $55,000. Okay, the part-time crossing guard costs Nassau County about $15,000, the total cost. So those, we're coming up on, when this next group gets hired, we'll have 200 part-time Corsa guards. Saves the county $8 million. And, you know, it really comes down to, where we have to manage the budget, and we have to look at the budget over the last several years. Within the agreement with the CSCA, one of the items was the part-time coursing that they would not, you know, that that was one of the concessions they got that helped them unfreeze their contract. But ultimately, when you have a 100% of part-time course guards, and it is problematic, I'm not telling you it's not, that'll end up saving $16 million a year. So, and again, the biggest problem we have with the coursing guards is not so much that I'm short 9 posts, it's that on a given day, a third of the coursing guards can take off and go sick. That's the problem.
And that would be like, to try to bring the numbers even greater, I would rather have an excess of school crossing guards. You know, even if we don't utilize them, I would, it still, to me, would be cheaper because we need to cover these school crossings. And since it's only $15,000 a year just for a school crossing guard, if you then take a police officer off of his or her patrol, where they have to cover that school, so that is even more expensive, of course, than that person.
It's lost opportunity.
Yeah.
I agree with you. Website four, I couldn't agree with you anymore, and that's my intent. My intent is to actually, if I need 400 crossing guards, honestly, I like that 430, 440 crossing guards, because the savings is so dynamic that it's worth the money, not, because think about it. I can pay a crossing guard $15 an hour, or I can take a police officer out of post and put him on a crossing instead of doing what he's supposed to be doing. I will tell you, I think, the administration, myself, the administration of the department, the unions, and I'm sure the legislators are all in the same exact place, the county executive, we're all in the same place on this. It's just a matter of getting to those numbers. And we're recruiting and we're working on it, and we're gonna, recruit another group, and we're gonna try to get that class of 100 investigators as quickly as possible, and hopefully we yield 2025, and hopefully we can get another class in. But also keep in mind, there's a lot of other work going on in NAPCA investigation. We're hiring EMTs, we're hiring PSAs, we're doing investigations for the DA's office, we're doing investigations for corrections, we're doing event. So basically, there's only so much throughput, so we're trying to manage and juggle the throughput. And what we have now is the biggest hiring in the police department, not just in police officers, but in CB operators, in AMTs, in PSAs, in crossing guards, deputy sheriffs, corrections officers, and we're hiring at a rate that we've never seen before.
Thank you, and I guess that you shared resources. I just have two quick questions, but I do want to thank you for your clarification on the school crossing guards as to the full-time, part-time. The AMTs, you said that we're hiring, there's an increase, but according to the budget, that it looked like it remained flat. How many AMTs do we currently
have? I'd have to get the numbers, but what you're looking at is the onboards versus the onboards. We're over budget right now, so we're above the budget. So the budget from last year, this year, and we are, we'll jock around budget positions, but we are looking to hire. We hired a class of 10, and I believe 3 or 4 have already failed out. So
it looks like it's 144 from last year, and then this year is the same 144. Page
431. Okay, right now on board I have 133, so we are going to look to hire that 11, and then we are expecting retirees that will also hire on board also.
Okay, all right. And with the 911 operators.
Yes.
I'm sorry, I should have looked at this more closely. But what is the, will there be an increase in the number of the 911 operators?
So I would have to pull the budget, but right now the onboard is 183, which is the highest number we've had in a very long time.
That would be the last thing. But I'm curious though, my last thing would be, why in this day and age are we still stuck with just paper on this? And this is not something
What's that?
This was the breakdown of something. Why isn't it like online? We handed this out at the beginning.
Yeah, I printed it out from a computer system that we've managed to draw some.
So we can actually get this online?
Yeah, well, you can.
Oh, I can.
You can get anything you want, I'll give it to you, but it's not accessible to the public. That's just, if the public wanted it filed before, we'd give it to them, but it's not a record that anybody, has ever asked for. This is the first time it's been asked for. And we went into the computer system. What I said was the parking tickets are not computerized. So we use a system called Trax. Okay, so last year's budget for CB operators was 161. And the proposed budget is at 193.
Okay, 193.
193 is the proposal. I gave you the onboards.
Okay.
So.
Thank you very much. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm just going to follow up, Commissioner, with the crossing guards. You said that the precinct 4 and 5 have difficulty retaining the crossing guards because they are so removed from their own home residence.
Yeah.
Is any effort made selecting the crossing guard for a particular location to the fact that they may be close to the area or too far from the area?
Historically, historically what we've done is just what you said. But that was at the point in history where being a crossing guard was such a desirable position because you go work 15 to 20 hours, you go work 20 hours a week and you have full health insurance. There's not a lot of jobs like that in the world. So we never had a shortage anywhere. But where we are now is we're basically hiring everybody that is approved, their background's approved. So it's, in the world that you're describing, that's what we hopefully, once we stabilize, hopefully we can get back to, only hiring people in the communities they live. And it's not like we take the crossing guards that live in the second precinct and send them to the fourth. You know, we'll take the crossing guards from the first precinct and send them to the fourth or fifth. So we're doing the adjoining precincts, but that's still, you can't get there from here, right? You go up into the fourth precinct. It's sometimes I think it takes me 45 minutes to get down to the end of the fourth precinct from police headquarters. I'm in the middle of the county.
So when we have more applicants than we need, there's a good possibility that they could be put in locations that are closer to
That's ultimately what happens. Whatever happens, wherever we hire them, as we've been hiring so many crossing guards, they're only in those locations for short periods of time before we move them into their resident precincts.
Because it'll help to retain them.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Okay,
and I just want to make it very clear, everything you're saying, I agree 100% with. I mean, it is a challenge, and it is something I don't want to ever see police officers on a crossing.
I don't either. Legislative level.
And just so you know, what we also have been doing, we literally spent several thousand dollars to advertise for crossing guards in all the local papers throughout the county. So we will continue to do that.
Commissioner, I just wanted to focus in on overtime. This year's budgeted amount is $57 million, my understanding, so we're coming in closer to 70.
Yes.
We have a budgeted amount of 57 again for 2017.
Yeah.
What level of confidence can we have that we're gonna come in near that number? You spoke earlier about the drivers and things like that, but we want some level of confidence that we're going to be able to achieve what's in the budget.
The first thing that we have working for us is, the first thing we have working for, we don't have a presidential election. That is a nice number right off the bat. The second item is, I would hope that we don't have another Verizon strike. We don't have a lot of businesses in Nassau County that affect us in that way. But with that being said, the things that we have going for us next year is a more stable, we're going to graduate 150, which puts us at just about 2450 on the street on January 1st. So we're going in with the most number of cops on the street in a very long time. We're also getting ready to team up a class to hire in the fall of this year, which the idea will be to push them out into the street by July 1st. So we're going in a more stable work environment. What are the unknowns is, it's truly anybody's guess on how many people retire. So what you have is, I've come here and when you look at all the models, but it's the unknowns that you can't predict. It's, do we have a storm? Do we have a hurricane next year? But if we have a normal year, and this is not a normal year by any stretch of the imagination, if we go back into a historical normal year, we should be in the neighborhood of just under 57 million.
But with this burst in hiring, though, we should be seeing savings not only just in terms of manpower, but their overtime rates have to be less than people they're replacing.
You know what, that is something that is, you've never heard me say that, but it is something that is logical, and I'll tell you why it's not the case. Generally, when we see police officers get hired, until they get off probation, they don't work overtime. So what happens is, we don't see the decreases in the blended rates that you would expect to see. You know, think about it, we have hired 700 people since May of 2014. That means they're making $35,000, $45,000, $55,000. Their average pay is $45,000. And so we roughly have about 35% of the patrol force that are out there driving those cars where the bulk of the overtime occurs are making a $45,000. So you should see a significant drop off in the blended rate of overtime, and we're not, because they're not working the overtime. And I can't compel them to work the overtime. So, I mean, I'm answering the question very honestly, and I don't like the answer. And if I was you, I wouldn't like, you know, but I can't compel them to work the overtime. And it is something that we look to work and, you know, encourage them to work overtime, let them know they can work overtime. But the reality is that history has shown us that's not the case. What you should start to see next year is that drop off of the rate as the people get more and more comfortable and come out of probation.
So after probation is over, that impediment will not be in place.
Yes.
They'll be eligible. Okay.
Right. So right now I have 400 officers on probation, close to 400 officers on probation. So that's a quarter of the patrol force is on probation.
And what's the timetable for those probationary periods to begin?
They'll start, there'll be groups that'll be coming off throughout, I believe one group, I can get you the actual times, but I believe one group will be this year, and then the remaining groups will be next year.
17, okay. Yeah. With respect to the contract, we were supposed to see savings in terms of the healthcare contributions and pension costs. Is there any way to quantify this? How much we're saving by these new hires under the new contract arrangements?
We actually did quantify that, and we can provide you that information. It is very real savings, you know. But also keep in mind, when we exited the wage freeze, we had 2,080 police officers. We now have 2,450 police officers. We have 20% more police officers on the job. And if you look at the salary lines, you're not seeing a significant increase in the salary lines. As far as the health insurance, you know, they are, everyone that's been hired, it doesn't matter if they were a county employee, every single one is paying the 15%, or they switched over to one of the alternative health insurance plans, so we're seeing that savings. But what you're also seeing is, remember, you see the increases on the salary where it's 3,800 employees, you're not seeing a big increase of the salary of the health insurance. Where you're seeing the big increases on the retirement side, where we're seeing a $7 or $8 million increase on the retirement. They're not contributing anything, and their rates are going up 7-8%. So when you actually look at $8 million increase, on the other hand, you look at, let's say, $2 million increase, but it's roughly the same pool of people that we're paying. We roughly have 3,600 retirees, and we roughly have 3,600. But one is four times the amount. So we're seeing those diminishing overtime costs. But unfortunately, when the rates are going up and being budgeted, you know, 7-9% a year, you know, inflation's near zero, and yet health insurance is going up, you know, 7-8% a year. Any savings is going to be overshadowed by the increase.
I think we have an understanding that it's going to take over the course of the careers of these individuals who are hired to achieve the savings over the time. But I think one of the ways to quantify it would be to compare what their contributions are as opposed to what someone's contribution under the old system would be. So
we have done that, legislator. I can give you that information. I've spent a great deal of time, you know, comparing what they would have made. And this is what, you know, some people don't realize is, In 2015, there was a poison pill that exploded the salary chart. That didn't happen. And I wouldn't be sitting here talking about the significant increase of the budget that we're talking about. It is significant, but there's a lot that's happened since we entered into those contracts. The biggest thing is we went from 2,100 sworn that we're now employed 2,450 sworn. So we've added 20% to the workforce but we've also increased the budgets on termination pay. We've also seen significant increases of the health, of the pension costs, because we are, you know, we're taking loans on the pension, and we're also seeing costs on, significant cost increases on the retirees' health insurance. So when you actually look at those things, but we wouldn't be having a conversation if under the old system, we wouldn't be talking about a $100 million increase next year. And that's the reality.
Just to switch subjects, this is a real achievement for the department, the use of force manual, and it's something that I think we can, it's probably a nationwide, we're probably at the forefront of nationwide policing in terms of doing something like this. But I'm looking at this and saying, there's a lot of information.
Yes.
Do you have something in place for continuing education? I mean, to be able to know all this stuff and to maintain it over the course of time.
Okay.
It can't be easy.
So a lot of that is like the logistics surrounding the use of force. So when we came out, when we changed the use of force policy 2 years ago, we actually brought the police officers in and we trained them on all the new policies, and it was a lot of changes. This time, it wasn't as dramatic, the changes that affected and impacted the police officers, but we did an in-service with them, and every single police officer had to take a test to make sure that they had that. So that was in 2 years. 2 years ago, we trained the whole department, and then we did an in-service where they were actually given the material, and they had to learn the material, and then they were tested on the material, and we tested them all. So it is something that we do monitor. It is something that we do watch. Additionally, the police officers, we don't get as much training as I would like. The police officers get a, a day of the range every year where use of force is basically the whole day, you know, prior to rounds and other refresher courses.
Okay, I would think that'd be vitally important.
I agree.
On a regular basis to keep them up to date, refreshed, et cetera. Six precincts, you showed the pictures of the new precincts going up to community policing centers. We took a tour of the building in July, and it was really substandard. I know that there's been some maintenance since that time, but is there a proposal in the works or any sort of capital work at the sixth precinct or community policing center?
There's a lot going on in the department, and you know, the county, this body, and the county executive have invested a significant amount of money into the infrastructure, and there is more work to do. The sixth precinct, you know, the seventh precinct, the fifth precinct, there is more work to do, but you know, you can only move, we're doing more construction right now than any point in the history of this department. Just to put this in perspective, you have, you know, I didn't get into everything, but you have the first precinct that's still being, you know, worked on. You have the fourth precinct, you have the second precinct policing center. We're right now building three warehouses, one for property bureau. I don't know if the CSA has talked to you. We have significant issues, environmental issues with our current property bureau, and that building is being built. We have a warehouse for the vehicles that are evidence in homicides. And then we have a warehouse for other high-value vehicles that we seize. So those are all being built. We're starting a planning. We expect to apply, and we expect to obtain a significant grant for a new operations center. So we're starting the programming and planning. You have the police academy, which is a significant undertaking. The academy we currently have is grossly inadequate. So there is a lot of the moving pieces. We did address the concerns that were raised related to the sixth precinct. And right now, there's nothing immediately on the boards to do a significant upgrade of that facility.
I understand that you have a lot going on, but there should be something at least in the pipeline.
Okay. So
because that facility is simply unacceptable, yeah, in my opinion.
I will start that process, sir.
One last area. Parking tickets, the records management system. I've had a constituent ask you for a breakdown of enforcement in a certain area for months, but apparently it's not broken down. It has to be done manually.
Yes.
Will this new record management system allow you to, in terms of parking tickets, determine how many tickets are being issued in a given area over a given period of time?
Okay. I'm trying to make this not boring, and I'm trying not to talk too much. People tell me I talk too much. Anyway, the records management system we bought had a module for traffic, parking, and accident. I know. It's Brazos. So Brazos has all three, parking, moving, and auto accidents. Unfortunately, New York State doesn't expect the data from Brazos. So we use Tracks because that's the only system that we can pump the information into New York State. And so Tracks right now only has movers and the auto accidents. What we are hopeful is, and what we've been promised by the state, and this is, again, I hate, you know, committing to what the state says. We're promised that the next update will have Tracks, and then next update Tracks will have parking tickets, and then it'll be able to have a lot more robust warning capabilities. But I will tell you this right now, I will not activate that module until it does have the parking tickets. Because to have a manual system in 2016 is lunacy. And the only thing more crazy is if I put another manual, I perpetuate that problem. So I won't put that Tracks module online unless they give me the parking tickets.
All right, thank you.
Legislator Birnbaum.
Hi. I want to thank you for reminding all the legislators that when you held up a placard of a Newsday cover story, it was the town supervisor of the town of North Hempstead, Judy Bosworth, who was vocally complaining in front of a large rally which was organized back in March that burglaries have been spiking in the area of the 6th Precinct.
Actually, they weren't spiking in the area of the 6th Precinct.
Well,
burglaries in the 6th Precinct were down.
There was a perceived notion that...
That's because the supervisor gave that perceived, even though she was fully aware of the fact that they were actually down in that precinct.
Well, there were many residents and electives at that rally who were forcefully, passionately speaking about reopening the 6th Precinct, and that was back in March. In May, there was another rally held right at this legislature where, again, the town supervisor came, she waited inside here for hours and then spoke in front of us about reopening the 6th Precinct. There was a petition signed by over 1,600 residents who all were arguing. We had a few of them here who were able to stay all those hours to speak in front of us. And you yourself said that the first priority of the county is to ensure the safety of the residents and visitors, which is what I think we all believe. And in most cities, even smaller cities, precincts are opening. They're opening additional precincts. Whereas in Nassau County, there was an idea 4 years ago to consolidate and to close certain precincts. And the building at the 6th Precinct had been deteriorating rapidly, and we all know there have been problems. I think there were photos shown back in May when they were here. Some of them have been addressed, and now you're saying we got to start working on them. We're building new precinct homes for other precincts, but in the meantime, the 6th Precinct, which the building is there, there's staff that just has been reassigned to other buildings, could come back. And I think it's a common belief among people that the overtime, part of the overtime spike has been because of this consolidation. Even the Comptroller's audit said that minimum staffing accounted for 55% of the overtime, which points to the fact that consolidation does not seem to be working.
That's not what it points to. Okay, minimum staffing would increase if you open the precinct, because you would have to take people and give them administrative positions instead of backfilling the cars. Number one. Number two, the budget before you does not consider a opening of that precinct. The budget is before this legislative body for action, and if there was 25 additional officers and that was the purpose of that, so budget was increased, you know, that would be the but that would be allowed for the budget. The controller talks out of both sides of his mouth. He is, first thing, when he did the original analysis of the precinct consolidation, his numbers for savings were significantly and materially greater than me and the independent budget office. Additionally, the independent budget office also did a review of this and made it very quite clear that it saves money. So, you know, I'm glad the controller has different opinions depending on what day it is and what door he goes out, but the truth is, the controller has conflicting reports. So I wouldn't put much stock or faith in what he says about consolidation of precincts.
However,
number two, I'm not done.
Okay.
Number two, the supervisor, knowing the fact that burglaries were actually down in the 6th precinct, still touted they were up. The bottom line is today they're down in the whole county at a rate of 7.5%. And that had nothing to do with the precinct being open or closed. That had to do with the great police work of the men and women in the Nassau County Police Department. Nassau County residents are safer here than just about anywhere. And I think it's high time that this, be recognized that the administration and the management of this department and the members of this department do a great job in providing a level of safety and security that isn't seen anywhere else. And, you know, when I first testified about the closing of the precincts several years ago, you know, everybody said crime was going to explode. And what I'd like you to do is take a look at what happened to crime in the last 4 years since we closed. It went down each and every year. I don't know, now we want to say it's about overtime. Well, it's not about overtime. It doesn't create any overtime. It doesn't cause any overtime. And as a matter of fact, if you take 25 cops from patrol functions and put them in a precinct, it will then cause overtime.
Is that a two-point? No, I didn't have the other third.
No, I have one, but
I know what you're saying, but the administrators who are in the third precinct right now do have additional overtime because all the men and women working under them, there's a lot more record keeping, a lot more administrative work to do.
So no, the administrators don't get overtime. So DIs and inspectors who supervise the precinct, people like myself, that we work 16, 18 hours a day, we don't get overtime. I don't get overtime, the inspectors don't get overtime. What we have is, it's, you're really, I don't know if you truly appreciate, but the only thing that changed in this was a logistical realignment. It didn't change patrol. We have the same number of cars, we have the same number of people. And, you know, we said it wasn't going to increase crime, it didn't increase crime, and we cut 25 positions out of the precinct. And to give you an example, in order to staff a precinct squad, so every precinct has a precinct detective squad. In order to staff a precinct squad, you have to have 5 supervisors. Okay, it doesn't matter how many detectives you have to have 5 supervisors. You have to have a CO, and then you have to have 4 additional supervisors. So in the 4th squad, the 6th squad, their caseload compared to the rest of the county was like a third of what the caseload of another precinct squad is. But then we also have to have 14 detectives. So they're not carrying the cases. So other places aren't getting the level of service they should be, because you have detectives sitting at desks with not a whole lot to do. And if you actually talk to some of those detectives that actually work in the third squad now, what they'll tell you is it's working a lot better because it's more even distribution of those investigative workload. You know, it's, we can sit here and go back and forth on this. I don't honestly think I'm gonna ever change your mind. And to be quite honest, you're not gonna change my mind. The 6th precinct is didn't lose anything. You know, crime in this county is down again. You know, right now as we sit here, close to 7%, you know, major crime. UCR is gonna be down. Total crime is down again. And, you know, so we continue to improve the safety and security here. When you actually look, that think about it, the UCR index here in Nassau County is lower today, significant, materially lower today than it was in 1966. And I think at some point in time, to be honest, I think you have to trust that the police department is acting in everybody's best interest.
Like you said, you're not going to change my mind, because I believe that part of the overtime costs, which have clearly spiked since 2012, is because of consolidation.
Mm-hmm. And I think I explained that.
Legislative Bynoe. Then Legislative Curran, and whoever else is there. Legislative Solages, you're on the down.
Fifth, Legislative Bynoe.
So I just want to touch base a little bit on the crossing guard discussion. Is there a possibility that public safety could be used instead of the police department when there isn't adequate coverage?
that would be out of title work. And the same way I ran a foul of out of title work with the crossing guards doing clerical work, I would run a foul there.
Okay, thank you. Public safety.
Just hold on one second.
Yes.
No, I'm just asking the lawyer. I just asked the lawyer.
Okay.
She said yes.
All right. Public safety. Did they receive Bynoe?
They should have received it. They were all called in to measure. I can't tell. They were supposed to come in and get it. We had body armor for them. I'm assuming that happened, but I'll follow up and confirm it.
All right, thank you. And then...
Lieutenant Stefanov will get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you. And then PERF.
Yes.
Did the final report come in from them?
We are right now with... The last module of this is a early warning system. I was, you know, hopefully we'll announce a really great early warning system at some point. And we've been meeting with PERF, we met with them last week they were in. So PERF was in last week. We started doing the training piece of this. They had to do ethics, and all of our supervisors and detectives will all be trained on the new ethics program before the end of the year. We expect a final report. The timeline is the second week of November, that it'll be. But the last module we've been working on is the early warning system. And for those that don't know, an early warning system is sort of like predictive problems when it comes to a police officer. So what we do is we basically draw in all sorts of data, and basically we take a look at that for indicators that we may have a problem employee before it becomes a problem. And then we get him the needed help. He's not done anything wrong. It's not a punitive sanction. Then we get him the needed, you know, training or assistance that he needs so he doesn't become a problem. And so we met with PERF last week. We actually had IA Pro, which is our management system, and they have a nice new module. We're expecting that the technology for that would probably be somewhere in the neighborhood of 200,000 to 250,000. Somewhere between 200,000 and 250,000. It's not so much the software that's going to be expensive, IA Pro. It's the interface I have to build with other systems to draw the information into that system in an automated way. So that each system is going to be $20,000 to $30,000. So we are working on that, and you know, so they're finishing up. That's the last piece that they have.
Excellent. This body had the benefit of meeting with the officials from PERF on the initial visit, you know, just they were doing some, I guess, gathering of information, fact gathering. I would think we would benefit equally if we had an opportunity to have a debriefing with PERF when they conclude.
You don't want me to debrief? No, absolutely. I'm going to see Chuck Wexler, Tom Wilson, and all PERF tomorrow morning in San Diego. So I'm giving a lecture.
Thank you.
So.
And that, you know what, I left out a question. I can't even understand my own handwriting at this point. But back to the crossing guards. So we mentioned that it was for cost savings that we went from full-time to part-time.
Yeah.
And so I just have to ask this question. Based on the fact that we seem to be turning over crossing guards, do we really know that it is a cost-efficient, you know, process right now in the... Because we're actually spending money to recruit, investigate, and train them, and then they ultimately leave.
So then
factoring the cost of our police officers covering the open slots. So
it's the police officers covering the open slots are covered within their own patrol responsibilities. It's not a cost; it's an opportunity cost. So basically, it's not costing hard dollars. Instead of them doing patrol, they're actually doing crossings, which is not, you know, good management. But we know it's saving money, and we know even with the turnover, part of the reason we've had so much turnover is because we've had poor incentives. And it's not the part-timers that we're having significant turnover of. It's the older retirees that are retiring from crossing guards. You know, crossing guards are, we never hired a lot of crossing guards. You know, literally that we've periods in 3, 4, 5, 6 years, we hired none, and we hired 8. It was a very desired full-time job. Think about, you know, working 20 hours a week, and getting $22, $25 an hour around, you know, your schedule, and then you're getting a full dental and medical package and a pension. So now what's happening is, because that grievance, we're starting to see Coast Guard separate and collect their pensions, which are pretty close to what they're making.
And then I just have one final question regarding the expenses that we will experience with the contractual increases for the police officers. Back in March of 2014, there was some documentation that was shared that illustrated that there would be some cost savings relative to, I guess, some savings from vacation, comp time, and personal leave. And I'm wondering why we haven't been able to actualize those savings.
And we have realized
this. Is there any opportunity for us to actualize that in 2017?
We have realized that. One of the things that we would like to give you, there's a lot of moving pieces, but to give you one example, the CSCA had a thing that allowed us to cancel vacations, and what we were able to do is we modified that slightly, where we reduced the number of vacation picks for the on a number of days for the CP operators. And we did that with the AMTs? No. We didn't do it with the AMTs. So we did it with the CB operators, and what we saw was that, you know, we picked up and we garnered the savings each and every day, and we more than achieved the savings that was attributable in that area. You know, the problem you have is that, you know, you're dealing with minimum staffing rules that we really have still just starting to, with this class, really be able to stabilize the workforce. And when 58% of the overtime is directly attributable to light roll call, that creates a little bit of a problem with the environment that we're in. Then you have a lot of secondary overtime from, you know, these details and the other items I described earlier.
Would you be able to provide me with an analysis that shows the projected from 2014 versus what was actualized?
Okay.
Yeah, well, last year.
I mean, that's very time. It's going to take us some time, but we'll work on that.
I appreciate that.
You know, it's very complex. And, you know, the big savings in this was not that. Those were minor savings. The big savings was the new salary charts. And, you know, those savings were under an assumption that we were going to hire 100 a year. We have hired, you know, with this next class coming in, we've hired about 750. So those people are making materially less money. They are paying into the health insurance. They are paying into their pensions. All those savings are have been achieved. Unfortunately, there are other alternative costs that were not part of those agreements. You know, when we know that every year we're going to have health insurance increases of 7%, well, the retirees, we're footing the whole bill, 100%. And that is $8 million for retiree health insurance. Out of that, you know, 15% of the increase in the budget is directly attributable to higher pension, health insurance that we're still paying. That is not, you know, that it was never, you know, said we were gonna reduce it, but the 750 people that were hired as police officers here are paying 15% less in their health insurance. They are contributing to their pensions, 9%, and our pension costs for those people went down 9%. But, you know, again, it's about, you know, those types of things, you know, that we have no control over.
I agree with you that the cost savings for the items that I discussed were much lower than health benefits, but they did rack up to some, you know, some.
Absolutely. And again, part of it is if, like, the CSEA items that you're talking about, we'll have to work with the budget office for those items, because those are countywide items, not just police department.
Okay, I'll wait for the numbers. Thank you, I appreciate it. Legislator Curran?
Hello.
So, just following up on what Legislator Bynoe was talking about, over time, I mean, the numbers show very plainly that overtime did spike after the consolidation.
It's also, remember, there's something, there's two things happened. We consolidated and we significantly reduced the police force. So, when we did the consolidation, the department was designed to be 2440, and we actually dropped below 2,089 people. So you were 350 people less than what we had. 350 people is 500,000 hours of staff below where it was designed. when we consolidated the precincts, it was designed to be at 2440, but we were 350 people below that number. So when you have that, each cop works 1,500 hours. So that's close to 500,000 hours that you lost in staffing.
Right.
And the overtime didn't go up that much.
So from what if these numbers that I have are correct, there are about 770 sworn staff that have 20 years or more on the job. So they can retire.
Are you sneaking numbers from around?
That's about 30%.
Yes, that's a pretty stable number, actually. That's actually down. It was as high as... You would think, but that would be problematic if officers left Nassau County in 20 years.
Okay. So most don't?
Most don't. You know, police officers stay an average of 21 years. Detectives are 24, 25 years. And supervisors are somewhere neighbor to 27 years.
The reason that number and that statistic caught my eye was because that almost seems like a double whammy, that we could all not live within the termination budget.
Yes.
But also the loss of personnel, of course, creating further overtime.
Okay, so the budget is a big, you know, is a document, and it's based on certain assumptions. But what we don't know is how many people are going to leave. So theoretically, could 750 people retire next year? Yeah, that theoretically could happen.
I'm sorry, say that again.
Theoretically, could 700 people retire next year? That could happen. 700, what's the number you have?
770.
77.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you that. I'm not retiring next year, so that's 769.
Okay, good.
So Lieutenant Stefanoff, you retire next year? But anyway, you know, my point is that we're not expecting 770 to retire. And if you look at the number over the last several years, it's been pretty stable with the eligible retirees. So what you have is, when we look at the retirements since 2009, the actual average retirements per year is about 110. Also, remember, if somebody that makes a whole lot of money retires, because we budgeted their salary. So if that individual retires in January, we budget a full year salary of that person. So there'll be, we will not use his salary, which will be freed up for the influx of overtime that's unexpected because we'll lose more than we anticipate, and there'll be money freed up for his termination pay. So the total cost of that officer may be over let's say with pension, is over $200,000, but we'll free up some of that salary that can be used to pay for the termination if there's a shortfall, pay for shortfalls in the overtime. So it's a, you know, you gotta look at the whole expense, the whole budget as a whole. Even this year, with the overtime being what it is, you know, in the case we are have opportunities, I think the budget office, the independent budget office identified them, controls office, I think, even acknowledged them, and I think they're underestimating the opportunities in termination pay, because between now and the end of the year, I only have two people that have filed for retirement, and I have nobody that's called to make an appointment. So I'm only going to lose four or five people between now and the end of the year.
Okay.
The next 3 months. So there is additional opportunity. But my point is that at the end of the year, our overtime budget may be above budget, but there's other opportunities within the budget where we'll come in under budget for headquarters and district collectively.
So net savings?
Net savings, yeah.
Okay.
Again, you know, headquarters might be a little bit high, district might be lower, but we'll have a net, surplus.
That's another question that I have. I understand that in headquarters, terminal leave is declining about $4 million,
mm-hmm.
and in district, it's increasing about $9 million. So why do you think you're going to have less in one than in the other?
That's just what we saw this year, you know, based on the mix of the retirees and based on the mix of eligible retirees, who's where next year. Mm-hmm. You know, when headquarters gets hit hard, it's those in cycles where, you know, where a significant number of the big bosses leave. You know, this year, like, we know that early next year we have Chief Swinecki that's going to be retiring. You know, his termination pay is rather large. So that, we, you know, but as far as I know, he's the only one, you know, planning to retire next year. But we look at that based on projections of where we believe, and it's a guess. I mean, it's an educated guess because we have the number 777. We have those. That's been a pretty stable number. It's actually 2 years ago, that number was probably 1,000. So it's actually numbers been dropped off.
You mean if those 20 years of service or more?
Yeah.
It's about 1,000. Yeah. So you say 770 is about normal and most will stay long.
Yes.
Okay. And then one more question, this is...
Sneaking numbers, Legislator Krumpter, can you give me the numbers next time?
You know, you said that next year we don't have any big things planned, but, you know, in life you expect the unexpected.
Yes.
And I'm just concerned that some things happen and that
Absolutely.
We might not be ready to pay for it.
You know, again, even with the presidential debate, even with the overtime that's above budget this year, in the total, the police department's budget, the headquarters and district funds will finish with a surplus. So we manage the budget, and you know, we manage all the lines of the budget as a single budget. So we'll look for opportunities in the events that you're describing. Can we ever be prepared for a Sandy or another hurricane? You know, that unless you're going to put a, you know, $30 million reserve in an event of that magnitude. But we have a lot of events built into that. We have the Belmont Stakes. We have a significant number of events. And there's always unanticipated events. But when you actually are talking, I don't think, you know, a year ago, anybody in the world would have predicted Trump was going to be the nominee for the Republican Party, and that Trump was going to run his campaign different than anybody else has ever run and host these rallies with 10, 11, 12,000 people. You know, I was looking at something in Michigan where his motorcade was compromised and they had a riot surrounding his motorcade. We didn't have that here in Essex County. And again, I go back to those types of events were unanticipated. We never planned for a presidential debate this year. We got notified 75, 80 days ago we were having a debate. We were told a year ago in October we were not having the debate, that Nassau was an alternate site. So those are anticipated events, you know,
right,
it's $1 million item.
Sprung on us pretty quickly.
So, and then you take into consideration the Verizon strike, you know, you take, there wasn't one event, there was a lot of different events. You take in the number of terrorist acts, you take in the number of, you know, direct assaults on police officers, we had to adjust resources. You take into consideration all those things, it was a perfect storm this year.
One more question, and this is a policing question. I honestly don't know the answer. Do young officers, when they come on the force, rack up more overtime than the older guys, who maybe are a little more forgiving, let people go? The younger guys are a little more, and women are a little more motivated, shall we say, and perhaps rack up more overtime with arrests and court time?
Well, you know, remember, over 50% is directly related to light recall. What we know is the young officers work less light recall.
Say that again?
Over 50% of the overtime is directly related to light roll call.
Light roll call, okay.
Okay, that
so they
minimum
don't
staffing.
As much
they don't, well, they don't work. They don't work. They,
no,
until they get off probation, that was a discussion we had earlier. Until they get off probation, they don't work that overtime.
Right.
But the other overtime is more ancillary.
What do you mean?
So it's not as. Hang on a second. Hold on 1 second. So if you look at minimum staffing overtime for 2015 was 457,000 hours.
Uh-huh.
Okay, direct police activity was 222,000 hours. So if you look up and down that column, other than 2012, where we had an anomaly, that's all your arrest overtime, that's all your investigative overtime. You actually look at that number, 222, that's where we actually have management ability. And you actually look at that number is on the lower side than the other numbers. Where we're getting killed is on that first column, the minimum staffing. So we have 222,000 hours of overtime and direct police activity. But that, you look at other years, 360, 261, 224, 215, 214. So you, as you can see, we're aggressively managed. And that's the stuff where we have a certain degree of flexibility. And that's the arrest overtime where we aggressively manage that overtime to make sure that's not being abused.
But you're saying that you don't have the flexibility with the minimum staff?
No, it's contracts.
Right.
I don't have, and I'll tell you right now, the court and indirect, I have no control over that too. I have no control over minimum staffing other than making sure that the you know, department is balanced appropriately, and I have no control.
What's an example of indirect? What coordinate indirect?
Indirect is if we have a, that's quarters, indirect, not she has that. Indirect, the best example is the Oyster Fest.
Oh, okay.
That's incorrect.
That's not said.
Unless we want to stop policing those things. You know, so we got to police them. We police them very aggressively. And if you look at the numbers, you know, 36,000, again, we really look to, we did everything we could, but the numbers are normally a little, we're averaging closer to 40,000 than 36. But again, it's the choice is, do we want to provide escorts or, you know, for fun runs that are fundraisers, and do we want to do those things,
right,
or do we want to stop doing those things?
And what is grants? What is that?
Grants is free.
Sorry?
Grants is free.
Free, we like that.
Free. So you want, that number you want a million hours.
Yeah.
Because it means somebody else is footing the bill.
Got it.
And to put it in perspective, grants this year were at 83,000. I think actually there's a problem with that number. We have to look at it. I think there's more than that. But last year we leveraged $100,000, $8 million of other people's money.
And admin support, that would be what you were talking about with, say...
Lieutenant Stefanos.
Right. And also...
It's his fault.
The police, when you have the police come and talk to the recruits at the academy, that sort of thing as well?
No, that's admin support is more the admin support administrative. That would be the police academy. Their staffing overtime, the applicant investigation, the 10,000 hours there. So that's 10,000 hours is
right.
Theirs.
All right. All right, that's all I got for now. Thank you very much.
Yes, good afternoon, Commissioner. How are you doing today?
Good afternoon, Legislative Solages.
Legislative Solages.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start off my comments today by saying that my comments are meant not to criticize, but to construct. On previous occasions, I've asked you questions, and at all to defame the great work and professionalism of officers, but only to construct and to ask for more transparency. So I just want to, first of all, thank you and thank the police department. I have a $64 million question, and that's this $64.3 million public safety fee. My concern with that, and I guess my concern with just raising fees, is that, you know, it has to be based on new service. You described all the great work that the police department is doing, but, you know, I haven't heard about something new that they're doing to at least justify this increase in fees. Can you please describe if there are any new units being added because of this $64.3 million public safety fee?
Well, within that $64.3 million public safety fee is a budgeted headcount increase of 230 police officers and critical civilian employees. That's the first. Things that we've already done is, again, we'll be looking to, as we described earlier, looking to shore up our homeland security and also provide additional officers really to try to aggressively go after that light work all overtime. There is the burglary task force that was formed this year. There was the heroin task force that was formed this year. You know, the fight against heroin, the fight against the drugs in general, this will provide those resources. You know, I think it's quite evident that our, you know, one of the biggest units that were increased this year was the pop cops. And I know earlier tonight, you know, I was advised that the majority leader and members of this body would like to see additional pop cops. You know, without saying, you know, it goes to the other increases within the budget, you know, or the alternative is we start reducing things in the police department. And as the Deputy County Executive for Finance, Eric Norton, stated, it's, you know, that is what was put forward by the county in order to fund this police department to provide a level of safety and security that we believe is the appropriate level. And, you know, ultimately, I think there's some other things to point out with is while that public safety fee will raise red light tickets to $200, there are a number of municipalities throughout the state that dwarf that number or above that number. You know, places like California where red light tickets are $490. Oregon where red light tickets are between $260 and $1,000. Illinois, red light tickets range from $100 to $500. Delaware, $75 to $230, Florida, $200, Washington, $125 to $250. So there are a number of places that these fines are not out of line, and you know, people that are violating the law, going through red lights, violating the vehicle traffic law, whether one of the biggest hazards, this country right now has the most traffic fatalities it's had in 50 years. And what happened? Well, DWIs we know are going down. DWI fatalities are going down. But we have this new driver distraction. These people are causing more hazard and more people die in Nassau County on the roads than die as a result of homicide.
But to my understanding, the AAA, my apologies for interrupting you, Commissioner. Mm-hmm. To my understanding, it's really very relevant to what you just said. The AAA just released a report stating that the number of tickets issued for distracted driving is low in Nassau County.
Well, like anything else, that's an area that we're always looking to improve, and we have issued a number of tickets. We provide you with a breakdown of all the tickets, and as I stated in my opening comments, we have provided new equipment that to our highway cops, and we are driving that item in particular because that is a concern. We recognize that we would like to do better in that area, and like everything else here in the police department, every year we look to be a better police department. We look to provide a better level of security and safety for the residents of Nassau County. But I think what the what we're really talking about here is the public safety fee, and to be quite that public safety fee provides a level of safety and security that I believe is the right level in this police department. I also believe targeting people that are violating the law, after distracted driving, after DWI, one of the most dangerous things you can do is go through a red light.
I understand.
T-bone collisions are horrific.
I understand, Commissioner. And I appreciate you describing, detailing that. You point to the new officers in the police academy, and you point to new civilians that will be hired. But of the $64.3 million raised from this public safety fee, paying for those officers would only amount to, what, $8 million, $9 million?
I would have to get the exact numbers, but I think more importantly, it's not just the 250 heads that we're talking about increasing. It's also about maintaining a department with 2,500 employees. And if you cut the budget, that headcount is going to have to be reduced.
I understand.
And if you don't support that item, that headcount is going to have to be reduced if you don't replace it with another revenue item. I was excited to come to this budget hearing. I've been doing this for a very long time. And because I've been coming here for a very long time and doing this, and I've testified before this legislative body pretty much dating back to 2002. And there was nothing better than coming here and saying, we're going to increase the police department by 250 people next year. Because that's a whole lot better coming in and saying, we can't have pop cops, we can't have this, we can't have that. So this legislative body has choices to make. The choice is, do you want a police department that has those items, or do we scale back and reduce the headcount and go in another direction? And I'll tell you right now, I think I've made a compelling argument, this is not the time to be doing that. It is the time to increase that headcount, because that $64 million doesn't just pay for the 250 police officers. It provides the police department and a level of service that I think is needed at this point in time.
But, and I understand that, but behind every decision is a cost-benefit analysis, and the benefit might be 230, 250 more officers, but the cost of that may be that you're driving so many people out of this county that we can't even raise the proper amount of property taxes. So, there's a balance to making these important decisions. But I ask you, what will be the police department's plan to support $64.3 million if there's a large public outcry and we can't raise our revenue? What would be your plan at that point?
At that point, we would have to, if this legislative body decided they're not going to increase the budget by $50 million, we would have to live within the budget, and we would have to make cuts. So what would be cut? It'd be all those ancillary units. It'd be POP. It'd be COPE. It would be cutting back on CERT. It would be cutting back on community policing. It'd be cutting back on major case investigative squads. And the list goes on and on and on. And you know what? You will impair public safety at that point. You cut $64 million out of the police department budget, make no bones about it. You don't vote for that budget in that way, you will impair public safety. Because what I'll be able to do, to be quite blunt, is to put the cops in patrol cars, and that's what we'd have resources for.
I refuse to look at the world in such black and white terms. There has to be other...
Well, how would you suggest we cut $60 million out of the budget?
A more aggressive plan when it comes to overtime. How about that?
How do I do that with the contracts? Do I ignore them? Because I can't do that. Oh, by the way, if I ignore the contracts, then they get paid anyway, because they go to an arbitrator. The arbitrator says, you didn't fill that car seat, you were legally obligated to fill, now you're going to pay that person 12 hours. Look at the numbers. Numbers are in front of you. Last year, 457,000 hours
roughly $50 million was directly attributable to filling the car seats. That's what it is, putting seats, cops in seats, putting CB operators in seats, putting ESU trucks in seats, putting Marine Bureau in seats. That's $50 million before we start about anything else. So you have, you know, there's always choices, you're right. So I guess we could just take everything out of the police department other than putting the people in the seats, and we can aggressively manage that over time. So there'll be no pop, there'll be no investigations, there'll be no nothing. And if that's the police department that you think can run this county and make it safe, you're sadly mistaken.
I did not suggest that. Again, I suggested that there has to be a more aggressive plan to attack the overtime, and I would like to hear more about that plan, please.
Actually, like I said, minimum staffing is just a matter of the function of the police officers in the seats, direct police activity. If you look at the number in 2015, it was 222,000 hours, 266 the year before, 261 before, 360 to 24. We are aggressively managing those areas where we have the flexibility. Court and indirect overtime, don't really have a whole lot of control, it's not a lot. Grants is not charged to the county. It's used with asset forfeiture, it's used with state homeland security grants, federal homeland security grants, and that is DWE grants, a bunch of other grants, countless grants, to the tune of 100,000 hours a year. Additionally, the admin and support, those are based on special skills at special times. We spend every day aggressively managing the overtime. After crime, after homeland security, the biggest focus in the Nassau County Police Department is overtime. We meet every week on it, we focus on it, we drill down into it. But as long as you have contracts in this county that provides the degree of minimum staffing that it provides, where I have minimum staffing in precinct detective squads, I have minimum staffing in 177 postcards, a bunch of them doubled, I have minimum staffing in every precinct, the only alternative to that minimum staffing and aggressively managing it, if you really want to eliminate it, is we can just start eliminating units. And that will impact public safety, because those are where we have flexibility. These are the contracts that are in this county, these are the contracts that have evolved over the last 30 years. And you know, I'm not gonna sit here and say they're good, I'm not gonna sit here and say they're bad, it doesn't matter what my feeling is. What I am legally obligated to do is put a person in those car seats. I'm legally obligated to put a person in those precinct squads. So your choices are very black and white. If you want to cut $60 million out of this budget, the price is going to be public safety.
Understood. Please, I believe I asked on the record, I guess the past budget hearing, for a formal report on the precinct consolidation savings. Did you ever produce such a report?
The report's been reduced. You actually also asked the Independent Budget Office, and they did produce the report, I believe. You'd have to check with them.
But I asked your office for a report.
We've provided the reports over and over again. If you want to keep providing data, we'll keep providing data.
No, but just one issue of contention is an issue as to the police consolidation plan and how successful that has been. And there are issues. You're stating that you knew what Supervisor Bosworth knew. You're talking about, you know what she thinks. And mm-hmm. Please, let's just focus on this issue of the police consolidation. I'm very thankful to have my precinct back, the 5th precinct, a great precinct where you started, but there are other precincts that are closed and they're providing less services, yet we're asking our constituents to provide more taxes. So
you don't even want to provide the increase in revenue, so why would you ask for more expenses?
All I'm asking for is an original report on the police consolidation savings.
Okay.
Did you have a such a report?
It's been reported, but we'll do it again.
Okay. In addition,
we've provided the data. We've met with the legislator, and we've met with members of your caucus and went over the data. But we'll keep providing it.
Thank you. When I lobbied members of my caucus for bonding for equipment for the police department, one thing that I asked for on the record was that our auxiliary police officers who do such a great job and risk their lives and without pay, to receive more equipment. Perhaps some of the equipment that was handed down from officers, now that they have bulletproof vests. I speak to auxiliary officers and they tell me that their batons have been taken away. I would ask respectfully, please, if there are any additional equipment that could be provided to these auxiliary officers.
So just a couple of things.
Yes.
This year, we provided auxiliaries with new radios to the tune of about $500,000 for radios.
I'm sorry, I didn't see a budget line for auxiliary officers in your budget.
It's not in the budget. It's part of the normal budget. It's within the special. It's not for auxiliaries. It's in the OTPS lines.
Okay. But is it under your department?
Yes.
Okay.
So we provided them new radios. Basically, where we're at with the auxiliaries is the only issue we currently have with the auxiliaries is the batons were not taken away. They've never had them. And it's, you know, we would need state legislation for them, number one. Number two, you know, that would require Albany to act to give them batons. With that being said, you know, I don't know that that's necessarily a good idea to give them batons. They're supposed to be eyes and ears. They're supposed to be observers. They're supposed to be see something, say something. They're not supposed to be actively engaged with the public in that way, shape, or form.
They should have something to protect themselves.
They are provided a significant amount of training, and they would just can't legally have batons in the current legal environment. So it's not even, you know, it's a discussion for another day. As far as all the other issues of the auxiliaries, every single issue that the auxiliaries had when I started 3 years ago as a commissioner, with the exception of the batons, has been resolved.
Understood.
So, I mean, there's been a lot of, there's been a whole grocery list of things that we've taken care of for the auxiliaries.
Okay.
Update
on the crime lab?
Updating the crime lab. Obviously, the crime lab isn't under the police department, but what I will tell you is the crime lab is well under construction, and from what I understand, the crime lab, the new building, will be open the middle of next year.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh,
one more question. I apologize. One more question. Just remembered it. I forgot if I remembered it. Thank you.
I don't think I'd like this question.
No, no. It's going to be fine. No, just this past Sunday, we lost Ken Thompson, a district attorney in Brooklyn, Kings County. He was 50 years old, rest in peace. He taught the young assistant district attorneys in his office that it was not just important to get convictions, but also to provide an exoneration where it was needed. District attorneys, I used to be one, you know, sometimes they may use discretion. It's just as important as using the right to prosecute. Same applies for our police officers. There might be situations where a police officer may see someone with an offense that can and they can receive a summons for, but they use their discretion and say, hey, you know what, you have a broken tail light, I'll let you go. But now with this public safety fee, I believe the effect on morale it will have in the police department is that it's going to encourage officers not to use their discretion and to allow people, it will encourage the officers to provide a summons where normally they would use their discretion and let the person go. Would you
like to
comment on that, please?
You know, one of the things I'll tell you is, our agency is not a very, we don't have the level of enforcement that other police departments have. And by that I mean is, our cops are out there and they always exercise a significant amount of discretion. I have no reason to believe that cops are gonna start writing a lot of tickets because they're worried about the county's budget lines. They don't usually pay attention to the county's budget lines. They're not concerned about what that. They're professionals. They go out and do their job each and every day. And I don't think this public safety fee is going to change how they police. I don't think it's going to cause them to write more tickets. I don't think it's going to cause them to write less tickets. Obviously, something we focus on is traffic safety. We are always focused on, you know, our police officers increasing the level of summons activity. And really, the focus is on those that are not, you know, for lack of a better way of putting it, pulling their weight. So if you have a bunch of people that are writing 7-8 tickets a month and you have one person doing zero, that's where we're really focusing our energy, on those people that aren't performing. But like I said, you know, it'd be my testimony and my belief that the public safety fee will not impact on how police officers go about their jobs. Either way, either more or less.
Thank you.